They have various duties. One is through the metering program. They monitor customer usage. We currently have 42,000 customers, both in residential and ICI, or industrial commercial sector. They look after meter repairs, meter changeouts. When we move to the new plant, we are going to have a section in there that actually takes the meters and makes sure that they're calibrated in compliance, okay, weights and measures. And we'll, our metering or billing department stayed with the hydro department, which is now PowerStream. And they've just become too expensive. So we can do it cheaper.
Good.
Just regarding the billing process, are they going to bill for anything less than the meter? Because you can break the pennies down on the charge down to the thousands of pennies. So I'm just wondering why you're not.
There is a basic charge to start with. There is a set basic rate.
Of course.
Just for the meter itself.
Right.
And then you get charged per cubic meter, I believe it is.
Yeah.
Okay. But it may come to that. Right now they're currently installing what they call the AMI system, the automated meter infrastructure. And basically every meter in town will be set up this way, and it will send an electronic message to the billing department of each customer's usage per day, and they can go to any house at any time and see what their usage is. So if there's a customer complaint about their meters now, they can go into that meter, look at it, and look if there's anything abnormal, you know. Did the meter get blocked, you know, did it stop running, you know, et cetera. They can tell if it's been tampered with, they can tell if somebody's tried to switch it around. It's quite amazing what this new program will do. And I wouldn't want to tamper with it. Put it that way. They've already put some in, and they've noticed some places where people, and they've been there like the next day, and we'd like to take a look at your installation.
So they can tell immediately.
Oh, it's automatic. As soon as it happens, it's pretty close. It gets flagged.
Wow.
It gets flagged. Any abnormal usage? Flagged. Okay. They also will investigate water quality, quantity, and pressure complaints. They'll look after your service flush if your line is plugging up. They'll deal with that. They'll deal with locates around your house if you want to put in a fence or something in the front yard, do some landscaping. And they're also responsible for the backflow prevention program. That's currently started up in the last couple of years. Mostly in the IC, most in the industrial, commercial, institutional area right now, and that's to protect the consumer. Basically what it does is it allows the water flow to go in only one direction. So if there is something out in the street that happens, a main break or whatever, no matter what the commercial process is in that plant, water cannot be siphoned back out into our system. And there have been occurrences of that. The most famous one recently was in Stratford with a car wash, where there was a problem out in the street, and the soap and that from the car wash got drawn into their distribution system.
Oh dear.
And luckily, somebody next door, or just across the road or whatever, happened to be running their water at that time, and they got the pink soap coming out of the tap.
Oh.
So that's the reason for that program.
Wow.
And it's incumbent on each business to look after their backflow device. They'll have to pay for it, and they'll have to have a check once a year.
Okay.
And the reason is to protect the public.
Oh yeah, that's a good reason.
So, and the last thing that we're doing is it's called the lead sampling program. That's been mandated the last couple of years due to an issue down in, I believe it was London, where they did some sampling and they found some high levels of lead in their water at residential houses. And it's basically based on older houses. The old houses that had the old galvanized services, the old galvanized piping in their houses and that. And the lead is leaching out of their pipes.
Well, downtown there's lots of old houses
there's 100-year-old houses.
Yep, they're 100-year-old houses, and we've been doing this program for, like I said, the last couple of years since it's been mandated. This program is based off of, you do it out in your system, and you test the house. So you can determine whether it's coming from the system or if it's internal. Okay. So actually today there's crew going around doing various houses right now. And what we did is we've called all the older houses and we said there is this program in place. We would like to arrange to sample your house twice a year at your house. And those people that agreed to it, because it's voluntary, we can't force to go into your house to sample water.
So what age of a house would you have called people?
I believe it's anything prior to like 1930, because after that time period it was mandated and buried to use copper.
Okay.
There is a date where they started using just copper.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And so anything before that time period, those people were contacted.
So
okay.
My house,
or the owners.
Okay. My house is 1947.
Probably
is
copper.
Okay.
Probably copper.
I do have some galvanized in my house, which we're gradually replacing, but the you're saying the outside
okay.
would be...
Yeah, well, I'm saying the copper, I mean, is from the
well,
street to the house.
Yeah.
What happens inside the house, we couldn't hold. City
yeah,
can
yeah.
control it.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay. So they would, if you want to have that checked, call customer service.
Oh,
and
yeah, so
they could put you on the list.
Okay.
You see?
Okay.
Of all the houses that we've done, initially I think we were doing 200 to start, twice a year. The first year or so we found, I think we had one or two hits, like
mm-hmm.
residential.
Mm-hmm.
And we had one or two on a hydrant that we found out was actually the lead, had a lead gasket on the ear of the hydrant. Okay. So when we went back to resample, there was no trace. So in this area so far, the lead is basically at the residential. And as part of that program, if we get what we call a hit, then we notify you, we give you the results.
Mm-hmm.
And so you know exactly what's there. But it's incumbent on you whether you rectify it.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? That probably shouldn't have been.
Mm-hmm.
And that's kind of... There was more than one reason for Walkerton. Okay?
For Walkerton? For Walkerton, you say?
For Walkerton to have happened, there was
uh-huh.
more than just an employee problem.
Mm-hmm.
Okay?
Mm-hmm.
There was a... From the top down, there became a systemic problem.
Yeah.
That got corrected. Okay, so since then we have a lot of regulations and acts. The Ontario Water Resources Act, that's been around for quite a while. That's not new. There is a new one for water taking and transfers. The Clean Water Act is fairly recent. That's to do with source water protection. Okay, and watershed-based planning. In this area, there's a South Simcoe study. If you want to look up that, we're actually part of that. There's a lot of information about our well field and where we draw our water from, et cetera, in that study. The Safe Drinking Water Act came in after Walkerton. That's Reg 170. That's the cornerstone of everything that we do and how we sample, what we have to sample, how often we have to sample. It's different whether you're groundwater or surface water, different rules. Reg 169 is the water quality, that's the testing. Okay, what we have to test, and what the parameters are, of what we can check for. Reg 128, the certification requirements, that's for the operators. That's for all the employees that adjust touch a valve in the system, operate a pump or whatever, we all have to be licensed. Depending on the class of the system, since we are a class 4 system, you need a class 4 operator, okay, to operate the system. We have myself and my supervisor, we're two of 67 operators in Ontario that are class class four on both water and distribution. There are a few hundred that have one or the other, whatever. Then there are a lot of twos, threes, level ones, entry levels, etc. But and everybody has to get recertified every 3 years. Okay, you have to be in the business to be able to be recertified, and there are requirements that you need to have. You have to have so much training, you have to have so much classroom time, etc. To carry on. Reg 188 is a new program that just started. As you see, 07 shows it's just recently. Is a drinking water license program, and that's basically Barry's now been accredited last year, and that you have to be accredited as an operating authority in the province. So you just can't set up a water system, hire an operator, and do water. You have to get accredited. You have to be licensed to operate a water system.
By the
government.
The province.
Yeah, water is a provincial responsibility. Okay. That's why it's the Ontario Water Resources Act. Okay. And that is about any questions? Although we've answered a few along the way. Yeah.
I live in the south end, and once the surface treatment plant is up and running, mm-hmm. would you recommend getting rid of our water softeners?
That will be a personal decision. We've asked that.
And it being too soft?
That's why I would say it's up to the person. I would recommend it being you test it.
Okay.
Only because of the fact that because we haven't gone through the full process on a full scale yet, that's coming in the next. We thought it was going to be this week, but I know in March. We're expecting to do a full-scale run of the plant. Until we do that full process and take some testing of ourselves, we won't know how much the process, like with the GACs and that, how it's going to take the hardness out of the water, how much material minerals will be reduced. But we do expect it to be softer, or less hard than the groundwater system. I live in the south end too, so I will be going on surface water,
okay.
And I will have my softener checked because I want to reduce the amount of salt I pay.
Yeah, and
you will save a lot of money.
Just tag along with that. Do you think it'll be a lesser quality of water, or there's more treatment going into it, right?
It'll be more treatment.
Okay.
Yeah, surface water is more expensive to treat the water because of the process it's going through.
Yeah.
Okay, so there. That's why in the last year the water rates have gone up, and in anticipation of that, and also to help pay for the plant. Depending on how that goes through, you know, there may be a few more rate increases to go with that, depending on how it goes. But still, we're average, like slightly below average as far as an average water rate for any utility like in the province. My boss lives in Springwater, and he's been telling me lately his water rates have really gone up.
Hmm.
When I lived in Midhurst many years ago, I think I paid $75 a year or something for water back then. And I think now it's $150 a quarter or something.
Wow. I'll pay that
more.
Okay. I'll pay that more. In and out? Water? $70 a month?
Well, $150 is for the water.
$39.36.
That's $150 a quarter for the water. I think the sewer is extra. It depends.
Yeah.
Depending on spring water where you live, some people have water systems, but they don't have a sewage system.
Mm-hmm.
They have their septic beds and that.
Mm-hmm.
So it depends on where you are in spring water. I think that's roughly what he said.
And when you're going to test your water, testing for sodium or for calcium?
You check for hardness.
Okay.
Check for hardness.
Okay.
And that's basically what your water softener is based on.